Hello everyone, welcome back. In this video I am going to explain about the trans diastereo selectivity in Johnson-Corey-Chekhovsky reaction. This video is the continuation of previous video where we have discussed about the preparation of sulfur islets and classification of sulfur islets. So next we continued the reactivity of sulfur islets. So in the reactivity of sulfur islets, so the reaction called Johnson-Corey-Chekhovsky reaction, which produces different kind of products such as epoxides, aziridines and cyclopropanes from the reaction between the sulfur islets with the carbonyl compounds, imines and alpha beta unsaturated carbonyl compounds respectively. If you observe this reaction, so this reaction generally produces all products like epoxide, aziridine and cyclopropane in trans form. So you are observing in this reaction a trans diastereo selectivity. Since cis and trans isomers are diastereomers, so this trans product formation taking place majorly in this reaction. So what is the reason behind in this trans diastereo selectivity in this Johnson-Corey-Chekhovsky reaction? Let us discuss about it. So as we mentioned in the mechanism in the previous video, the initial step is the carbanion present in the islet acts as a nucleophile and attack onto the electrophilic carbonyl carbon or imine carbon, which gives you a Jeter ion intermediate. So if you observe, this initial addition is completely reversible. So the degree of reversibility is generally depends on the substrates, that means the stability of the substrates. Suppose if the stability of this islet is more, then this reversibility or equilibration is towards this islet formation. And this reversibility is depends on the formation of intermediate. If suppose this Jeter ion intermediate is stable, then the equilibration in this reaction shift towards the formation of this intermediate. So the reason between the reason behind this trans diastereo selectivity in this reaction is the formed Jeter ion intermediate can have two different type of possibilities, either anti or syn. See, that means the formed oxygen anion and this sulfonium ion in this Jeter ion intermediate, if they are in anti, then this is anti-betaine, whereas if they are same side, that is syn-betaine. But the formation of this Jeter ion is in anti-betaine form. So this reaction between the initial addition, that means between the sulfur islet and this carbonyl compound, generally gives you anti-betaine more favorable than the syn-betaine. So that is the reason in this case you are getting trans products always major. And in this reaction, the initial addition generally produces the betaine intermediate with the adjacent charges. The DFT studies, that means density functional theory studies, shows that the rate limiting step involved in this reaction is generally the central bond. The central bond present in this intermediate, generally it is necessary for the attack of this oxygen anion, the resulting oxygen anion, from the backside to this sulfonium ion. So that is the reason this reaction prefers trans products formation majorly. Let us discuss about the mechanism why this trans diastereo selectivity occurs in this reaction. Let us discuss a mechanism by taking an eyelid, for example. I have an eyelid where the positive charged sulfur atom connected to negative charged carbon. Once this eyelid, if you treat with a carbonyl compound or imine, so generally the initial step is the nucleophile, that means this carbonium acts as a nucleophile and attack onto this electrophilic center. So this reaction is generally reversible, that is depends on the formation of this intermediate. Suppose if the intermediate stability is more, then this reaction equilibration shift towards the only intermediate side. Suppose let us discuss three different cases here. For example, if you have substance R1 and H here, the attack of this nucleophile takes place from the front side or top side. Suppose consider this as a case one. So for top side, that means the front carbon is this carbon, allylide carbon, and backside carbon is this electrophilic carbon. So that it gives you an intermediate, which is butane with the adjacent charges. So the first carbon and this back carbon has so the intermediate. This intermediate generally, what happens? As I mentioned, this incoming nucleophile, that means this oxygen anion, which acts as intranucleophile, that means it acts as a nucleophile, so that it intramolecular nucleophile, it attacks to the electrophilic carbon from the backside. So when it wants to attack from the backside, this oxygen anion and the leaving group, the sulfonium, should be anti to each other. So for this requirement, you need to rotate this bond. So this conformer can be rotated by 120 degrees. So this leaving group will shift towards anti to this oxygen anion. So when you rotate this by 120 degrees, so that this oxygen anion will be anti to this leaving group. Okay, now this oxygen anion attack onto this electrophilic carbon so that the leaving group leaves. So which gives you an product where this R2, which is behind or below or far from the observer, and this R1 is near to observer. So the formation of this stable intermediate results the equilibration towards the intermediate only. So in this reversibility, degree of reversibility is depends on the stability of this intermediate. So the intermediate stability is more here because there is no steric interaction between these two also. So that is the reason this intermediate favorable, that means intermediate formation is favorable. So the degree of reversibility and equilibration shift towards the intermediate formation. So this is case one. Come to the case two. Take the same allylide. Now just attack this one nucleophile. The initial addition is taking place from the, consider another case where the initial addition, that means nucleophilic addition towards this electrophilic carbon takes place from the backside. That means now you are getting this, suppose if it is carbonyl compound, this carbonyl compound you will get a front side near to the observer. You can see first I am drawing here X minus R2H. Whereas that side. So as I mentioned, this oxygen anion, which acts as intramolecular nucleophile, so it has to attack this electrophilic carbon, which should be anti to this leaving group, that is sulfonium, so that this sulfonium should come to the anti to this X minus. So we have to rotate this bond by 120 degrees, so which brings this . So in this case, now you are getting these two, incoming nucleophile and leaving group, are antiposition. So now this attack at the electrophilic carbon, so that the loss of this dialkyl sulfide takes place and results the trimembered ring. So where this R2 is present near to the observer, whereas this R1 is behind the far to the observer. That means these R2 and R1 are antipositions. See, they are trans. Here also in this case R2 and R1. So in these two intermediates they are stable. They are stable, so that's why the equilibration shift towards the intermediate, because see here the steric interactions are very less between these two groups or atoms. So that is why these intermediates are stable. That's why this reaction gives you trans product majorly. Whereas consider another case where change the groups, rotate these groups. See, earlier R1 and H, now we are rotating these groups and the same attack this nucleophile. Onto this electrophilic carbon, which results an intermediate . As we know, these two incoming nucleophile and the leaving group should be anti to each other, so that rotate this bond . See, if you observe in this intermediate, when you rotate this and brings this two in nucleophile and this leaving group anti to each other, you will observe the steric interactions between these two groups. So that is the reason you won't get cis product in this reaction. So that is why this reaction is not favorable to formation to cis. Only it is favorable towards the trans isomer, majorly this reaction, because of this steric interactions. So there are totally three cases we have discussed. In the case one, the nucleophilic attack towards the electrophilic center, which is initial addition, which brings the stable intermediate, that is betaine, where the total incoming nucleophile and outgoing nucleophile, that is the leaving group, are anti to each other, so that they feel less steric repulsion. So this intermediate favorable and it gives you trans product majorly. As the same in other case also, in the case 2 also, because of less steric repulsions, this intermediate is favorable and gives you trans epoxides or azidines majorly. Whereas in the case 3, so this intermediate feels somewhat steric repulsions, that's why this reaction not giving any product here. So that is the reason behind this trans-industrial selectivity in this Johnson-Cory Chekhovsky reaction. So this reaction, this Johnson-Cory Chekhovsky reaction has different kind of applications in organic synthesis. For example, if you take a benzaldehyde, treat with the dimethyl sulfonium methylide. So this reaction generally results a trimembered heterocycle, that is epoxide or oxidane. So the mechanism involved in this reaction is, the initial step is the nucleophilic addition. The carbenium in this elide acts as a nucleophile and it attacks onto this electrophilic carbon of carbonyl compound, which results a deuter ion . Now this oxygen anion, the formed oxygen anion, has high affinity towards the carbon over the sulfur. So here the sulfonium is a good leaving group, so that this carbon gets electrophilic nature. So this oxygen anion acts as intramolecular nucleophile and attack onto this electrophilic carbon, which bears the good leaving group, that is sulfonium. So the loss of dimethyl sulfide gives you the epoxide product, which is made. Consider this mechanism. The first step is the initial addition of this elide, that means carbenium in elide. Okay, it acts as a nucleophile. When it attacks onto this electrophilic carbon, then again in this elide, the same carbon is acting as the electrophile because it bears a good leaving group, that is sulfonium. So the same elide, first it acts as a nucleophile, followed by again electrophile. So the loss of dimethyl sulfide, which produces epoxide or oxidane. Come to the other application, where the reaction of acetophenone with the dimethyl sulfoxonium methylide, which is also called as Chekhovsky reagent, Cory Chekhovsky reagent, which gives you an epoxide. So here in the both cases, in the first example and in this case, both cases, you are inserting it methylene group into the substrates. So that is the reason you are getting epoxides or trimembered rings. So what kind of mechanism involved in this? So first step, in the first step, this elide carbon acts as nucleophile and attack onto this electrophilic carbon of carbonyl compound, which results a betaine intermediate. Followed by, again this carbon acts as an electrophile. So this oxygen anion acts as a nucleophile and attack this electrophile, and this reaction proceeds by the loss of DMSO, dimethyl sulfoxide, and gives you our required epoxide. So consider another example where reaction of an aldehyde treat with the dimethyl sulfonium methylide, which also gives you an epoxide. So in all cases we have observed the insertion of CH2 into the substrate. Come to the other application. For example, if you take two amino benzaldehyde and treat with dimethyl sulfonium methylide. As usual, the insertion of CH2 takes place and this carbonyl compound successfully converted to epoxide. Now this epoxide has an electrophilic carbon, so this nucleophilic amine attack onto this electrophilic center and gives you 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. So it gives you a 5 member ring. And further loss of water which gives you a heterocycle called indole. So that is the reason I told you this Johnson-Corey-Chekhovsky reaction has diverse applications in organic synthesis. Let us take another example. If you take an imine, treat with the dimethyl sulfoxonium methylate, this reaction also gives you azeridine followed by intermolecular nucleophilic attack, which gives you a 5-membered heterocycle derivative, that is benzofuran, that is 2,3-dihydro benzofuran derivative. So we can also get here benzofuran derivative by converting this amine, secondary amine, to tertiary amine, that is quaternary amine, followed by the loss of this quaternary amine gives you benzofuran derivative. So these are the applications. That means this Johnson-Corey-Chekhovsky reaction has a diverse applications in organic synthesis to prepare different kind of heterocycles such as epoxides, azeridines, indoles, dihydrobenzofuran derivatives. So we can also use this sulfides catalytically in this reaction to produce the epoxides. For example, if you take a dialkyl sulfide, so convert this dialkyl sulfide to a sulfonium salt by treating with a benzyl bromide. This is the preparation method for sulfonium ion. So for example, here the sulfur which is having lone pair, it attack onto this benzyl carbon, that means it undergoes nucleophilic substitution reaction and produce sulfonium ion. So now this sulfonium ion, if you treat with a base which abstract the proton from here and forms a vicinal ionic intermediate called sulfur elide. This sulfur elide, once you treat with the an aldehyde, so which results the formation of epoxide followed by the loss of R2S, that means sulfide will come back. So that means these sulfides you can use catalytically in this reaction to produce these epoxides in the reaction. First, in the first step, this dialkyl sulfide can be treated with the benzyl bromide, or it can be alkylated to get the sulfonium salt. This sulfonium salt can treat with the base and gets the elide, which is vicinal ionic intermediate. And now once you get this elide, you can treat with the carbonyl compound, which gives you a corresponding epoxide by the loss of dialkyl sulfide. That means this dialkyl sulfide will regenerate it back in the reaction, so that if you use catalytical portion of this dialkyl sulfide also carry out the reaction to produce this epoxides in the reaction. So that is the diverse applications we have with the Johnson-Corey-Chakovsky reaction. So in the next video, we'll be continue the synthetic applications of this sulfur halides in organic synthesis. Thank you.